Bringing in Kevin McPherson now. Kevin, we were just discussing Arkansas electing to vote in the 35-second shot clock for the 22-2023 season. Now, it's already going to be implemented in the 6A by then, but just kind of your initial thoughts to when you saw this news break earlier this week.
Well, it's overdue. I mean, Arkansas basketball, it has come in so far. And if you look back at the last decade, the players, the level of talent that's coming out of the state to feed into the high major level and really all levels of Division One, Arkansas has made a lot of strides in terms of the quality and the culture in basketball. But without a shot clock, and we've seen a lot of states move to it, and I get to travel and watch a lot of different basketball in different places, it's a big difference at that level. And I think it promotes, it furthers players' skill level in dealing with situations with no shot clock. It's not just about boring basketball. I think it also stymies the progress of players and their development because you don't really have to do a whole lot if you're standing there and you know, milking the clock down and guys are standing around. And it's just not, you know, it does not promote the game. And I don't think it promotes development in the game. So I think it's a great idea. It's long overdue.
Kevin, when you look at this Arkansas basketball team, they got some major news when Isaiah Joe announced his return over the weekend. I know that a lot of players are excited. I know that you've got inside sources talking about what's going on in these in the training camp. Just kind of your biggest takeaways with what you've heard so far this last week or so when it comes to what's been happening with Arkansas basketball inside those practices.
Yeah, I mean, getting Isaiah Joe back is you're getting a pro, you know, I call it a five-star recruiting win for Eric Musselman. He doesn't look at it as recruiting, but at the end of the day, you know, a guy that could have gone and taken a paycheck is coming back to play for you. So you're doing something right inside those doors for him to want to come back. And then the big takeaway really is he was absent the first couple of weeks. You had a couple of guys that we know now have been injured, J.D. Notte, Bebe Iliola. Those guys have been out, but the takeaways for who's on the court, you know, a guy like Vance Jackson, they put him on the court this past week and let him, you know, work a little bit in that point forward spot that Mason Jones made famous in the SEC last year because his versatility and, at the end of the day, the ability to have a prolific scoring season, you know, unlike any that's been around in the SEC in 30 years. I'm not saying Vance Jackson's going to do that, but 6'9", pushing 240, we knew he was bringing perimeter skill, the ability to knock down threes, find little creative ways to drive down and get into, you know, scoring position in the paint in different places in the mid-range. And so, you know, if he's on the ball out on the floor at 6'9", 240, that's a matchup nightmare if he's able to actually – that translates to the season. So they looked at – that was a look they had. Everything I've heard about Justin Smith, the 6'7 grad transfer from Indiana, not only a big leaper, but his effort day-to-day – he's a guy that's going to make a difference. He put up career numbers last year at Indiana, nothing spectacular, you know, over 30 minutes, 10 points, 5 rebounds, but a guy I think Arkansas will be able to count on. And that 48-inch vertical leap is, you know, that's elite. I mean, that's as good as it gets, basically. And so that's a guy that can not only finish in transition the way that fans is going to bring fans out of the seat, but I think it's a guy that's going to be able to have some versatility defending perimeter inside. So those are some of the big takeaways on some of the newcomers. You know, Connor Vanover at 7'3", he's a guy that when we got to see him in practice last year, and you may remember this, Ty, you know, when the drill part of the work, he doesn't necessarily stand out, but when you get into the live competition stuff, 3-on-3, 5-on-5, he starts to come alive. You know, he was impressive in Arkansas's red-white game. His only real game action with fans in the seats last year. Thought he had a good game there, hit about like 3 threes, 15 points. But I just think overall when you start piecing together the newcomers, and then that includes those freshmen, Moses Moody, Jalen Williams, K.K. Robinson, Devontae Davis, hearing good things about all those guys, Jalen Tate, the 6'6 grad transfer that's going to be that Jimmy Witt role defensively and kind of be a slasher and a combo guard on offense and bring the ball up some. I just think when you look at the collective unit, it stacks up for a team that can get back to the NCAA tournament. And then you put Isaiah Joe in there with the other veteran that's been around for a while, Desi Seals, another double-figure scorer, by the way. I think Arkansas's got the pieces to be deserving of some of these way-too-early top 25s. And the potential later, I think, and I've written about this, to maybe be a top 15 kind of a team that could potentially make a run in that NCAA tournament beyond the second weekend, beyond the first weekend into a second weekend, which would be, if they did that, a first in 25 seasons.
Yeah, in a league that's going to be loaded and nationally really good this year. You listed a lot of pieces there. You named a lot of players. We've been kind of kicking around potential lineups this year. I'm of the belief the lineups may change based on who you're playing, that there may be as many as 10 players that see to see significant playing time this year. Who do you think are the two or three maybe absolute starters? I think like an Isaiah Joe, maybe a Moses Moody will be, you know, game in, game out starters. How do you see a lineup getting constructed? Do you think it's going to be more of a game-to-game thing, or do you think there will be five players that will be more night-in, night-out guys for Eric Musselman?
Well, that's actually a key question. And Musselman's track record is a top seven or eight rotation. So that makes you tend to think that he's going to stick with a top seven or eight, identify those early in camp. That's how he does it. And we saw some dynamics change on that even last year because Arkansas was so thin on that front line and they had injuries. So we saw a guy like Ethan Henderson. We saw times where it was Reggie Chaney. And typically those guys were kind of the eighth and ninth men, but they even found, you know, at different times their minutes and their roles increased. So I think with this team, you've got so much versatility, and not, it's the biggest Arkansas team. I don't remember the last time Arkansas had so much height and length. Mm-hmm. I think collectively skill-wise, this is going to be the best three-point shooting and passing team. Those are things that lend themselves to Musselman's professed, you know, speed and space offense. So I think there's so much versatility in that lineup. I think he's got a lot of options that could bring starter value. So to answer your question, I'm not sure he's going to get outside of a top seven or eight, but through the season, I think we might see 10 or 11 guys that move in and out of that rotation. Some of it based on matchups and personnel, some of it based on opportunity and development. Most certain guys might pass others. But at the end of the day, I think your Isaiah Joe is obviously a day one starter. I think a Moses Moody probably should be. We'll see. He's got to earn that. And then I look at Desi Seals as a guy with starter value. Whether he comes off the bench in a six-man role or actually moves back into that starting lineup, I think he's a guy that's going to bring that kind of value. And those three grad transfers guys, they didn't come here to sit. Those guys are going to play significant roles. You know, you'll probably hear all three of those guys naming that starting lineup often, you know, at least having big roles if they're playing somewhat off the bench. And then guys like Connor Vanover and J.D. Notay, you set out last year, all we've heard are good things, and I think those guys are going to play significant roles as well.
You know, you could see last year, Kevin, that the frustration of having the lack of size, you know, having to watch Vanover sit on the bench, not having players over 6'9" available to Eric Musselman. He's going to, I think, relish and use that size in one or two spots and probably two spots as often as possible, just because he remembers what last year was like and having to go small so often, not having a lot of guys over 6'8" on the floor. So I'm sure he's devising a lot of plans to utilize the size that he all of a sudden has compared to last year's team.
Yeah, and let's look at it this way. Musselman likes to play a lot of two-man game. Out front, we saw a lot. We saw Mason Jones and Isaiah Joe actually setting screens and playing two-man game with each other. Then Isaiah Joe got hurt. We saw even, you know, Adriel Bailey and Jalen Harris in that role trying to help Mason get screens and play off of that. You've got a huge talent, skill, and size influx upgrade when you don't have Adriel Bailey and Jalen Harris, but you've guys got guys like Connor Vanover, Vance Jackson, Justin Smith. You've got different types of guys that bring different things to the table that can finish a shot. So it doesn't have to be your best scorer that you've got to rely on to take shots as much now. It could be anybody. And I think they're really going to play a lot of space the floor and a lot of five out. Even with all that size, they're going to be able to do that. Then they're going to also be able to go inside. People don't always realize Connor Vanover is a tough shot maker in the mid post.
Working on that sky hook, Kevin.
He's working on the sky hook. And look, defensively, he's a good volume shot blocker for the minutes he gets. And on top of that, who's counting? Where's the statistic on how many shots he alters and is going to alter? 7'3" with that length? Mm-hmm. He doesn't have to be quick of foot necessarily when he's playing inside. He's just got to turn. You know, if he turns toward a guy, he's going to change their shot just by raising his arms.
Kevin McPherson with us here on the Morning Rush. Kevin, we haven't heard much chatter about the 2021 basketball recruits. I know there's some guys that they missed out on their top eight, top six, or whatever. We know the 2022 in-state class is loaded, but what have you been hearing as far as 2021 recruits that may or may not commit to Arkansas as of late?
Well, you know, a week ago I wrote a story about coaches around the country, including Arkansas, needing to possibly be more deliberate in recruiting because of the absence of live evaluation in the spring and summer. You know, that's really my thrive time of year covering high school and grassroots basketball, because that's the evaluation time, and there's been no live eval. So to answer your question, Musselman in his press conference Monday sort of validated what I wrote a week ago. Look, Arkansas is going to take a, you know, things have changed because of the pandemic. They're probably going to go a little slower. Having said that, you look at the roster, we know there's three grad transfers leaving due to natural attrition in college basketball. You can probably double that number, five or six guys by the end of the year that you're replacing. And I think, who are the guys, where are the areas of the biggest concern? Jalen Tate, 6'6", going to be gone, backcourt player. Isaiah Joe, probably going to get back in the draft and stay there next time, 6'5", perimeter player. Moses Moody, could be Arkansas's first one and done. We don't want to jump ahead too far, maybe not, but another big guard, 6'6". So I think Arkansas is looking at big guards right now, and if you look at guys like James White, 6'5", out of Conyers, Georgia. You look at Chance Moore, who, by the way, is going to visit Fayetteville with his dad this weekend, a top ESPN top 44 national guy, another 6'5 guard out of Georgia. And you look at, so there's some big guards and wings that Arkansas is looking at 2021. And then when I'm looking at the front line, you're going to, we just talked about the versatility of Vance Jackson and Justin Smith. You know, the interesting piece with new associate head coach David Patrick and his ties to Australia and all the great recruiting he's done there in the past, guys like Patty Mills and Ben Simmons, you start looking at Australia, there's a couple of versatile combo forwards that are in the 6'9 to 6'11 range. David Okwara and a guy, a Cole Mawane, who I just wrote about in a story yesterday, that played here in Central Arkansas at Southwest Christian Academy. I got to cover him for a couple of seasons. A guy that had a really good year last year at Navarro College, junior JUCO in Texas. So keep an eye on those guys, that Australia connection, because David Patrick's had a lot of success with that, and I think he's already starting to kind of move pieces around the board to maybe set Arkansas up with bringing in players that he's had success with, the kind of players he's had success with out of his home country in the past.
I want to pair something together. You said earlier, you're talking about the 7-8 player rotation that Musselman has traditionally liked. And then the thought or the idea that I think is reality, that you could have a shortened college basketball season. We've already seen Division II basketball shorten the season from 30 to 22 games. The idea that you could play only conference games, I think, is a real reality that we could be facing. We know you're long on juniors this year. You got an incoming freshman class. Could you see this program maybe utilizing or using some red shirts this year with players in order to maneuver some players around with their years? How do you think they'll maybe handle that if you have a severely shortened season due to the pandemic?
Yeah, that's another great question, because of all the unprecedentedness, that's not a word, but everything is new for everybody. Right. Players coming in now, these high school players don't expect a redshirt. They see themselves as having a short path to the next level. And when you've got four top 100 guys that made up a top five national class, according to ESPN, it's going to be hard to have that conversation with one of those guys, but they may have to do that. There's other players on the roster, if you look at it, that could potentially be a candidate for something like that, especially when you've had some injuries. So, but both of those injuries so far are guys that sat out last year. So it's a Musselman's in a spot there, but you're right. If it depends on how much they squeeze down this season, there could be potential to say, hey, guy, look, you're not going to get the most out of this season. We've got less time to, you know, you're not necessarily in this top 7-8 rotation as it is, and now we've got fewer games. Maybe let's take a look at this. So I think that's a great question, especially with how Musk plays his rosters. That would maybe be a built-in reason to help convince somebody that let's take a year off here.
Kevin, as we let you go with this, man, Kentucky came into Fayetteville last year. Unfortunately, the Razorbacks lost a heartbreaker and kind of couldn't close it out down the stretch. This upcoming season, I think in the past decade, the Wildcats and the Razorbacks have only played twice in a season, and that was, and just once, and that was back in 2014. kind of based on what's going on, how bad do you think Razorback fans, and particularly those players and that coaching staff, wants another shot at Kentucky in Bud Walton Arena with this current roster?
Yeah, I mean, I think it would be, you know, just like it was last year, it brought back memories of the mid-90s, but you had all the students and fans outside just gathered in throngs. You remember that atmosphere, Ty, you were there. And I think that it's the whole thing. It's the pageantry. It's Kentucky. But it's also Arkansas had a good enough team to beat Kentucky last year. They almost did. The problem was Isaiah Joe, that was one of the games he played in injured. And I think that really, when you go back and look at those 11 games, five playing hurt, we didn't know how hurt he really was, but we figured that out because he missed six games because he had to have a procedure. Arkansas struggled, 3-8. One of those losses was Kentucky, a game they could have won with a hobbled Isaiah Joe. And we just said it. Arkansas didn't have a lot of height and size. They didn't have a lot of depth. You get those guys back in Bud Walton Arena this coming season, I think the excitement level, as great as it was last year, I don't know how it could get better, but I imagine it would be. Now, we know the pandemic is going to squeeze off likely what crowds would look like and things like that, but that doesn't mean that excitement won't be generated. And I promise you, Eric Musselman going to figure out a way to get the entire state somehow involved in some sort of celebration, even if it's in their own homes, lead up to that game.
And you bring up an excellent point. We'll top off the interview with this. Imagine, like, this is the most highly anticipated team, and some would say since the 90s. Imagine not being able, not because you can't sell the tickets, but because everything going around the world right now. Imagine telling fans that, hey, you can't go to this game, yeah, even though this team's top 25, even though they're playing Kentucky.
You're playing a lot of top 10 teams.
Yeah, yeah. Even though the SEC is as loaded as it's going to be, Kevin, you can't fill up the arena even though you want to more than anything.
And listen, Bud Walton Arena, when things are when Arkansas's got a good team, even when they're down, if you get good crowds in Bud Walton Arena, it's worth three or four possessions for you, 6 to 8 points. And so that factors into to how good you can be. And you're going to be in some tight games or spots where you need that crowd's energy. Yeah, so from a fan standpoint, that's going to be tough. I think for the team, you know, they feed off that kind of energy. People know Arkansas's got one of the best, you know, basketball crowds in college basketball. And when things are rolling and that place is filled up, it makes a big difference. So there are many ways to look at that and say, man, thanks, coronavirus. I mean, really, you know, I don't want to be too playful about that. It's been hard on a lot of folks, but as far as sports go, it's going to be hard enough to get on the court. Once you do, then you've got those factors that play in that are still, you realize things aren't normal.
Yeah. Kevin, appreciate your time as always, man. We'll talk whenever we talk to you next, dude.
Good to be with you guys. Thank you.